Because it is expensive and often impossible to eradicate established aquatic invasive species, preventing their spread is the best and most cost-effective option. This can usually be accomplished by making sure that boats and any equipment or gear that's in contact with the water gets clean, drained, and dried. For some invasive species, there are some special considerations to ensure they aren't spread. Being out of water for 5 days is typically enough to kill young zebra mussels and larvae. However, adult zebra mussels can survive for a couple of weeks out of water in ideal conditions. In 2012, the Minnesota legislature passed a law requiring a 21-day dry time for docks, lifts, and associated equipment before you can place them in a different lake or river. This is to avoid the problem of adult zebra mussels surviving in dark, damp, cool conditions inside long dock posts. Keep in mind, this law does not apply to any boats or other types of equipment. Remember, it is illegal to transport zebra mussels, dead or alive, unless a citizen or lake service provider business has a permit to move infested equipment back to a designated decontamination site. Make sure you drain water to avoid transporting larvae. Clean all mussel shells from equipment before going to another water body. There is a similar concern with spiny water fleas and a resting egg they lay near the end of their season. Even if these eggs are dried out, they can survive extreme conditions, and if transported, can infest new water bodies. Drain water, wash off muck that might contain resting eggs, and wash off any globs of adults on downrigger cables, ropes, and fishing gear. These steps will help reduce the risk of spreading spiny water fleas to new waters. To remove faucet snails, boaters need to scrape or wash their boats and gear with a hot, high-pressure water spray. Because invasive carp can look like other young bait fish, never put unused bait in the water. As a rule, don't release any aquarium fish into the wild, and don't stock any fish in outdoor ponds without a permit.
None of these steps to control the spread of aquatic invasive species work if people don't know about invasive species, don't understand the damage they cause, don't care about the problem, or don't know how to properly clean off these invaders. Ultimately, outreach and education are the simplest and most effective way to ensure people know how to reduce the risk of spreading aquatic invasive species. The work you and other volunteers and ambassadors do to inform and teach people is a critical part of this public outreach. Your work goes hand in hand with the DNR's outreach to news media and the DNR's watercraft inspections and decontaminations. Now would be a good time to review the duties and requirements of aquatic invasive species volunteers and of ambassadors.
As you know, aquatic invasive species volunteers and ambassadors primarily work at the water axes that DNR and local government staff are unable to visit. To serve in these roles, you have some specific requirements and duties. Both volunteers and ambassadors are required to undergo an annual background check with the DNR. You are also required to attend an in-person training every 3 years. On the alternate years, you must review this recorded refresher training. If you are an aquatic invasive species volunteer, you are either assigned to a water access site by the DNR or you select a site. Your educational efforts for boaters are conducted under a DNR volunteer agreement. If you select your own water access site, you must submit a schedule to your regional DNR Watercraft Inspection Program supervisor 1 week in advance, listing your planned activities. volunteers are not allowed to be paid by a local government unit for their outreach efforts. If you're an aquatic invasive species ambassador, you're able to work at any water access. If it is a DNR access, there must be a $0 grant agreement in place with a local government, such as a city or county, to oversee the work of the ambassador. If it is not a DNR access, you must get written permission from the access owner to educate people at the access site. The owner could be a city, a county, a power company, other state or federal agencies, a Native American tribe, or a resort. As an ambassador, you are allowed to be paid by a local government organization to do your education and outreach. Ambassadors need to submit a schedule at least 24 hours in advance to their regional DNR watercraft inspection program supervisor. By the end of the boating season, volunteers and ambassadors must submit their volunteer hour totals to the regional DNR watercraft inspection program supervisor.
New infestations of aquatic invasive species are found periodically in water bodies. The DNR fishing regulations include a list of infested waters to aid anglers. However, you'll want to know the most current information for the water access where you're working. For this, check the full list of infested waters on this DNR webpage. This list is continually updated and is searchable for specific water bodies, species, or areas. You should remind visitors that all public water accesses have signs listing what invasive species are present and the rules for cleaning their boats and equipment. They can also call the local DNR office or talk to a DNR aquatic invasive species specialist or a DNR watercraft inspector to find out if a lake is infested.
Once you have your information in hand, you're ready to set up at your water access. We want to make sure that your education site is safe for you and doesn't cause traffic congestion. You'll want to become familiar with your surroundings at the access site so you know what resources you have available. Do you have cell phone reception in case of an emergency? Is there a restroom available? What is located nearby? A store, gas station, park office, or medical facility? As you work at the access, you might run into situations in which you'll need to use these resources. If possible, bring a folding chair that you can set up on the driver's side of vehicles entering the water access. This way, you can talk to the driver without walking around the car or truck. Try to make sure your education site will not cause a traffic backup at the access site or on the roadway to the access. Bring any equipment you need to help with your public education, such as a wrench to help watercraft owners remove and replace drain plugs, invasive species identification cards, and informational brochures on aquatic invasive species. You must have a sign or wearable items that identifies your group and helps people understand what you are doing at the access. This could be a hat, vest, or polo shirt, to name a few. As a volunteer or ambassador, your safety is always the priority. To avoid heat stress and sunburn, you should use sunscreen, drink plenty of water, and move into the shade on hot, sunny days. Check the weather and dress appropriately for the day's conditions. If you're working at a busy public access, you may want to wear a bright-colored, reflective safety vest to increase your visibility to drivers. If you're working at a public access that has trees and tall grass, wood ticks may be present. You should take steps to prevent getting bitten by wood ticks. The Minnesota Department of Health has recommendations on its website. Because you will be walking on some wet surfaces, it's wise to wear slip-resistant shoes. Although rare, if a boater is argumentative, avoid conflict. Back away and try to calm down the situation. Remember that your role is to be an educator. Boaters are not required to talk with you or follow your instructions.